5,000 years ago, a great civilization known as the Minoans flourished on the island of Crete. Their powerful fleet ruled the Mediterranean. Minoan artists recorded their world, creating exquisite figures and stunning frescoes. But at the height of their powers, they were wiped from the pages of history. Their disappearance is still one of the ancient world's greatest mysteries. Some thought the Minoans were slaughtered by conquerors from overseas. Others, that a cataclysmic eruption destroyed them. Now, scientists have found evidence of a dreadful disaster that overwhelmed Europe's first great civilization.
You spend a lot of time looking for something, and then when you find it, you wish you hadn't, because it becomes too real.
Did their terrible fate create the myth of Atlantis, the city that drowned?
They worshipped the sea, and here is the sea that's turning against them.
Thousand years ago, the Greek historian Plato wrote about Atlantis, the fabulous civilization that was swallowed by the sea. But no one has been able to trace the origins of Plato's story. Now, there's new evidence from the island of Crete. It points to an extraordinary event that could have inspired the Atlantis legend. Was the destruction of Atlantis a folk memory of what happened to the Minoans who flourished on Crete long before Plato? Until only a century ago, the Minoans too were a mysterious people. They were known only from Greek myths about monsters and human sacrifice. Archaeologist Sandy McGillivray has been studying Minoan culture on Crete for 25 years. He's on his way to explore caves once thought to be the home of the legendary Minotaur. The creature, half man, half bull, was imprisoned in an underground labyrinth by King Minos. It dined on human flesh.
There were all kinds of stories of hauntings and weird happenings in here. Still a place associated with doom and death.
The Minotaur had very particular tastes. It liked to consume its human prey alive.
To keep the Minotaur fed, Minos exacted a tribute of 7 maids and 7 youths from the Athenians. And once you entered the labyrinth, you never left the labyrinth.
This terrible myth was virtually all we knew about the Minoans until 1900. Then, British archaeologist Sir Arthur Evans began excavating on Crete, near the village of Knossos. What he found astonished the world. He uncovered a sophisticated Bronze Age civilization. While most Europeans were living in squalid huts, these people were building palaces. The Minoans' capital was a masterpiece of prehistoric town planning. Its temples, townhouses, and granaries were connected by Europe's first paved roads. Knossos was also the workshop of the Minoan world. Skilled craftsmen produced everything from basic foodstuffs to the most exquisite treasures, like the harvester vase.
You've got a little choir of men with skull caps on whose mouths are open. The wreaths that some of them are holding, you can almost hear them blowing in the wind, rustling against each other. These pieces are symphonic in every way. It's a revolution in art.
As Sir Arthur Evans excavated the magnificent ruins, he grew more certain that Knossos was the palace of King Minos. He even believed he'd found the royal throne. But Sandy McGillivray believes that Evans was wrong. For him, this building is far more than a palace. It's a temple to harness the magical power of the sun.
What we're looking at here is the solar temple.
Each of these doorways is aligned with the rising sun on a particular day.
What we have here then is essentially a theater of the senses. You can start off with complete blackness, and then you can fling open these doors at that moment of sunrise and experience that beginning of something new. And in the winter, the sun comes through on the winter solstice and illuminates the throne.
But the throne wasn't the seat of a king. Instead, worshippers would have seen a high priestess celebrating the birth of a new year and reforging the Minoan bond with nature.
Whoever's on that throne is basically being illuminated by the sun on the day when the sun is reborn.
Female figurines found at Knossos suggest a cult of snake priestesses, reinforcing the idea that this was a temple. Frescoes discovered nearby seem to show worshippers gathering to celebrate the rebirth of the sun.
This place is more like a ceremonial court center, a place of interaction. A place where people from all over town, but also from outside of the place, came to visit and take part in communal gatherings.
Like the Egyptians, the Minoans worshipped the changing cycles of the sun, the moon, and the stars. Their religion was an attempt to keep them in harmony with forces that were beyond their control. But their religion was to let them down. 3,500 years ago, this mighty civilization disappeared. Their fate is still a mystery. Were they wiped out by Greek invaders? Or was it a catastrophic natural event, like the one that supposedly destroyed Atlantis? The island of Santorini, less than 70 miles north of Knossos, may provide a clue to solving the Minoan mystery. The wild scenery and jagged cliffs draw countless tourists, but they don't realize that this is a highly explosive volcano. Nor did a colony of Minoans who lived on Santorini 3,500 years ago. Their town of Akrotiri was discovered here in 1967, buried on the slopes of the vast crater. It was, in its day, as wealthy and self-assured as the settlements on Crete. Floyd McCoy has been studying the volcano on Santorini for 25 years.
If you take a look at the wall paintings that have been discovered here, they are portraying their landscape. It's a happy landscape, animals bouncing around and people picking saffron. They were showing a nice, nice lifestyle, a comfortable one. It's a pity it was all destroyed.
The Minoans had built their beautiful city on the most dangerous island on Earth. Around 1600 BC, Akrotiri was shaken by a violent earthquake. But this was just the beginning.
And suddenly, this thing exploded.
Kythira was erupting. The vast volcano blasted ash, gas, and rock up to 25 miles into the stratosphere. Evidence of the eruption is all around Santorini, in deposits up to 60 meters deep.
There, in that cliff face, all four layers representing the four major faces of this huge, dramatic eruption. The first layer that we see is that brown layer at the bottom, that granular brown layer. That's pumice. Pumice is frothy rock. It represents magma frozen in place, a frozen explosion.
But it's the layer on top of this pumice that demonstrates the real power of this mighty eruption. This is the ash left by pyroclastic flows.
Pyroclastic flows, hot gas material that comes up and flows laterally across the landscape, sometimes at supersonic speeds, hot, hot gases.
These gases were forced out by massive explosions in the heart of the volcano, the caldera. But what caused these blasts? When the magma first erupted out of Thera, it left behind a huge empty chamber. The surface above the chamber collapsed, creating a vast cavity. Then the sea rushed in.
Magma and water do not mix. They make an explosion. The entire Aegean Sea is pouring into this vent, mixing with new magma coming up, and the explosion was tremendous, huge. And from that come these pyroclastic flows.
But the third layer best demonstrates the awesome force of this eruption. This 10-meter deposit of ash was left by a single, monstrous pyroclastic flow.
At the top there is a fourth phase. There's a rock layer that goes right near the top. It started to rain. Torrential rains came down. And then all this loose ash and pumice on the surface started to move down slope. That's what we call debris flows. And then it was over.
Was the Thera eruption powerful enough to have destroyed the Minoans on Crete? In the 1980s, Floyd and his colleagues found ash deposits on neighboring islands and on the seabed near Crete.
We calculated the amount, the volume of this material, which is how we figure out how explosive an eruption was. It came out something like Krakatoa. Wow, we said.
When Krakatoa erupted in 1883, the explosion was heard 2,000 miles away, and the disaster claimed 36,000 lives. Then, more evidence of Thera's deadly deposits began to emerge. Computer modeling expert and volcano enthusiast, Dr. Stuart Dunn, decided to plot the results.
We put together a database of all these ash thicknesses, these recording their locations and recording the thickness in centimeters.
Each numbered triangle represents a deposit of ash from Thera. The location and thickness of the ash residues allowed Dunn to calculate how many millions of tons of material were blasted across the region.
We concluded that the eruption was very, very much larger than had been previously thought.
We were all wrong. This was highly explosive. Now we're up to 10 times the explosivity of Krakatoa.
We really are talking about the largest volcanic event in human history in Europe.
What was the impact of this terrifying event on the Minoans? The volcano spewed out huge plumes of ash. When the dense clouds appeared, it must have seemed to the Minoans on Crete that nature had turned against them.
Imagine this ash coming over the island, and we know what happened. It blackened the air, it blackened the blue sky for several days, probably, and that is pretty bad for people living with nature. We have evidence from other societies where they really get stressed, traumatic stress, because of this ash fall.
Stuart Dunn's computer map shows the Thirin ash that has been found on the east of Crete. Several centimeters fell in this part of the island. But there is also a surprise. Prevailing winds blew much of the ash cloud away from Crete. The west is virtually untouched. But if the ash didn't cause the Minoans' downfall, what did? Archaeologist Sandy McGillivray has been grappling with this question for the last 20 years. He's been excavating the Minoan coastal town of Palaecastro on eastern Crete. Palaecastro sits on the edge of a great natural harbor, sheltered from Mediterranean storms. The extent of the ruins found here suggests that this was the largest Minoan settlement after Knossos, home to 5,000 people, stretching from the mountainside to the sea. Paved roads with drains were laid out on a grid pattern in Europe's first town plan. The town was sited on a gentle slope running down to the sea. Today, the small hill the town stands on is eroding into the water, revealing a strange layer of chaotically mixed material.
I used to come down here to the beach, and I would see these gravel deposits. We had Thirin ash, we had pottery, and there was building debris, there was all this chaos, and brought a number of specialists up here and said, well, you know, can you explain how this gravel got up here? And one of them suggested that there was a river flowing up here, and I thought, a river? How, you know, why would a Minoan build their house in the middle of a river, and how could a river run over a hilltop? That made no sense whatsoever to me. And I thought, let's get people to really investigate this properly.
Sandy had never seen anything like it before. So he called in soil scientist Hendrik Bruins.
Look here, we have stone, pottery, and lots of lumps of volcanic ash. This is one lump, this is another lump. This is, from a sedimentary point of view, this is impossible to get, let's say, by an earthquake, and it's impossible to get by natural archaeological stratification.
But what caused this chaotic deposit? Hendrik takes samples to see if they contain microscopic clues which might reveal how the layer was formed.
So this is the hardened block made from the sediment which we took in situ at the promontory, the soft brittle material, hardened afterwards. Here we have the slide, the thin section that was made from the block.
Under the microscope, an astonishing find.
We were really very, very thrilled when we saw foraminifera in these deposits.
Foraminifera are the shells of tiny organisms only found beneath the sea. It suggests that the deposit is from the ocean. Perhaps a bad storm could have blown the foraminifera onto land. But there is another marine creature within the soil sample, coralline algae from the seabed.
These come from below the sea level, and in order to deposit them in that level where we found them in the promontory, I mean, it has to be scooped up by something. It has to be lifted up to a much higher level where the sea normally never comes.
No storm could have lifted algae from the seabed and left it stranded 5 meters up on the island. But there is an awesome natural force that has the power to do this. In 2004, the world was shocked by the force of the Asian tsunami, the monstrous wave generated by a subsea earthquake. It killed 230,000 people and devastated entire coastlines. Could this have happened to the Minoans 3,500 years ago? Is the Palaicastro beach deposit the terrifying footprint of a tsunami? Sandy calls on leading expert, Kostas Sinolakis. Kostas has studied the devastating effects of tsunamis all over the world, including the monstrous wave of 2004. As soon as they reach the beach, they find newly exposed Minoan pottery fragments mixed in with the gravel.
These are cattle bones here. You can see floor plaster and wall plaster. You can see building material, and you see a lot of typical pottery. Okay, have a look at this deposit here, Kostas. There's the conical cup sitting right there. It's 5 meters above Minoan sea level.
When Sandy invited me to come out here and, you know, look at some of the evidence, I was very skeptical. But nonetheless, I was really keen to see what Sandy had. Sandy, I mean, if this is all the Minoan deposit, it must have been something really massive. I mean, something of the scale that we have just not even started thinking about. What happened here?
What about the excavated ruins of Palaicastro, just 300 meters from the beach? Here, there is further evidence that something extraordinary happened. The buildings show unusual signs of damage.
We find some walls entirely missing. We find...
Entirely missing?
Yeah. Like the late Minoan, one wall along the bottom there is gone. That half of the building is gone.
And of course, this is what we see, you know, in modern tsunamis. We call this the blowout. The sea comes in, tsunami comes in, blows out the walls. If the building is strong enough, the side walls, you know, will survive. But the walls facing the ocean, they're just going to collapse.
All of a sudden, a lot of deposits began making sense to us. Because we had these buildings pulled away, we had the fronts of buildings missing, we had buildings raised right down to foundation level.
What kind of wave was powerful enough to cross 300 meters of land before demolishing a town?
The first step is to get a better picture, if you will, of the seafloor.
Kostas uses a simple sonar system to plot the contours of Palaicastro Bay. The probe harnesses echolocation to measure the depth of the bay, showing how it shelves in towards the shore. The shape of the seabed here affects the height and size of the waves approaching the beach. To calculate the size of the wave at Palaicastro, he also has to establish the furthest point the wave penetrated the bay. To do this, he will need to find telltale evidence of the presence of sea on land. The next day, they begin their search at a new road cutting nearly a kilometer from the shore.
That's a seashell.
That's outrageous.
I don't believe this. It's all exposed. And, you know, look, there's more.
That looks to me like the rim of a hemispherical cup. The period of theory eruption.
The cutting isn't just a kilometer inland. It's well above sea level.
It looks like we're at 31.36 meters. Hard to believe. It's just...
That's about right. We're cooking.
It's all here.
We are cooking.
They are also looking for the tiny marine creatures that Hendrik found on the beach. But environmental scientist Anaya Sapaki may already have the answer. For the last 20 years, she's kept all the samples from excavations at Palais Castro. Do they contain the telltale microscopic signs that the sea once engulfed the land?
In this particular sample, we have found Graminifera.
Oh my goodness. Is that what they look like?
Mm-hmm. It's the evidence they've been looking for, that the ancient wave traveled hundreds of meters across land.
What Anaya has found is extremely exciting. Anaya's foraminifera, the wall, and then the debris layer, well, there's no other alternative explanation that can simultaneously explain all these findings other than the fact that the tsunami was really big, much bigger than we thought. It came through, destroyed the town, and pretty much covered most of the plain behind me.
So what caused the wave that destroyed Palais Castro? Was it a subsea earthquake, or was it the eruption on Thera? Hendrik Bruins hopes a fragment of cattle bone buried in the tsunami deposit will confirm the link between the wave and the volcano.
What I would like to see, if possible, that the bone would give a date, a radiocarbon date, that is similar to the date for the Minoan Santorini eruption, because then we have very, very hard scientific evidence that we're talking about the same time, also in radiocarbon time. So if this radiocarbon date that comes from this bone would be similar to the radiocarbon date of the Santorini eruption, then it's very, very important scientific evidence. That's one piece.
Did the greatest volcanic eruption in human history generate a tsunami powerful enough to destroy not only a single town, but to ravage an entire civilization?
There we are.
Could this bone hold the key to the story of Atlantis, the great city that disappeared beneath the waves? The team continue their hunt for more evidence of the tsunami across the island. They search along the north coast, where any tsunami generated by Thera would have struck. But centuries of erosion by wind and sea make evidence on the ground elusive. They reach Malia, 50 kilometers west of Palais Castro. This is the site of the third largest Minoan palace, just a kilometer from the sea. If a tsunami struck the north coast, this royal complex would have been extremely vulnerable. This layer on the beach near Malia looks like the deposits at Palais Castro. Erosion has exposed bone, masonry, and Minoan pottery. And right in the middle of the layer, a seashell.
Wow, look at that.
Very good.
Very good, very good.
Excellent.
See, this is from the sea. So this strengthens our working hypothesis that this is a tsunami deposit.
The significance of it, at least to me, is that it adds tremendous credibility to the deposits that we have found in Palais Castro, right out there in the promontory. It's much more useful to us to have two deposits that are at the distance of 20 miles apart from each other, 30 miles apart, than having two deposits that are next to each other, because then we have a better geographical constraint, and that helps us identify how wide the wave is, what was the width of the wall of water that came towards Crete.
Now they know the wave was at least 30 miles wide, but could it have been even bigger? The The next day, the team reaches Amnisos, home to the Minoan fleet and close to the palace of Knossos. Pumice from Thera was once found in the ruins of this Minoan villa. The petrified volcanic froth might have been brought in by a storm. But if they can find Theran pumice higher in the hills behind the villa, it might suggest it floated in on a massive tsunami.
Well, if we can find some pumice up here...
Put your eyes where your mouth is.
Let's try to find some pumice.
They're searching at 20 meters above sea level.
This is it.
That obviously is volcanic. See if it sparkles.
But it's rounded. Yeah, this is absolutely pumice. There's no doubt about it.
Do you realize what this means for the height of the tsunami?
Okay, is there any other way that these little tiny pieces of pumice got up here? How else could the pumice get here? It's not a souvenir.
Well, how far in are they? Because if they're so close, the wave would still be quite high here, but if there's more in there, then I'll start getting scared.
There's tons of this stuff up here. This is outrageous. Actually, when it comes down to it, this is totally outrageous.
You could get destruction down there with a wave that's maybe, you know, 3 meters high. Who knows how strong the house was. But finding pumice, I mean, up here is unbelievable. I mean, this is huge.
As a child, there was a big anthill at one end of the garden, and we used to go with the garden hose and wash them off. And that keeps coming back somewhere in my memory. And I keep thinking that wave had an effect like just washing ants off an anthill and sweeping them out to sea. It's a terrifying thing. Those ants never had a chance.
With evidence accumulating for an island-wide tsunami, Hendrik is keen to establish the cause of this giant killer wave. He's been waiting for the radiocarbon date of the cattle bone he found on the beach. Will it confirm the team's theory that the volcano generated the tsunami? The results arrive. The date is 1600 BC, an exact match of the definitive date for the Thera eruption.
The cattle bones, they are of the same age as the Santorini eruption, and it proves that also our chaotic tsunami deposit has also in radiocarbon terms the same age as the Santorini eruption, which is superb.
The team are now certain what caused the wave, but just how big was it, and what damage could it have done? At the lab, Kostas can finally produce his detailed computer model of the height, length, and width of the wave.
Yes. We've created the monster.
The red and green peaks show the highest points of the tsunami.
The size of the wave here, mm-hmm. So just to give you a comparison, is equivalent to what the wave looked like off Sri Lanka and off Thailand. And you know how many people died in Thailand, how many people died in Sri Lanka. I mean, Thailand reached, you know, 20 meters. It's the same size wave right here.
20 meters.
But the real shock isn't just the size of the tsunami. It's the realization that there were several of them.
It's having a party.
When the caldera collapsed, it sent several walls of water out into the Aegean, like a pebble dropping into a pond. These waves cannoned around the islands and bounced off them in a deadly game of tsunami pinball.
It's coming in. It's now, yes.
Crete was hit by several rebounding waves.
What are the intervals between with this wave
Let's have a look. This is about 33 minutes. And now we have
the first wave coming in.
And now you have the second one, and that's at 46 minutes. And then you have another wave in about half an hour later, which is not as big, but I mean, it has to be terrifying because by that time, everything, I mean, the people have run away. Maybe some people are coming back to help, you know, the wounded, to try to find, you know, family members. And then this, you know, other wave comes in and sort of finishes the job.
This is horrifying.
Yeah.
It's absolutely horrifying. My reaction to seeing that model was a bit like watching 9/11. Because, I hate disasters. You know, it's like you spend a lot of time looking for something, and then when you find it, you wish you hadn't. Because it becomes too real. And you can, you know, you begin to feel the experience. This is life, this is people just being washed out to sea, bashed around, knocked against walls, ships coming ashore. You know, there's a whole instant that flashes through your head.
Striking observation that I've made, just talking to people, you know, all over the world, I mean, when it's tsunamis, whether it is, you know, Nicaragua, or whether it is Sri Lanka, or whether, you know, it is in the Philippines, they tell you about the noise. The tsunami comes in and, you know, they tell you that it sounds like, some people say, like falling rain, others tell you that, like, it's like an airplane landing. This impression, I mean, this, what you hear time and time again, irrespective of where you are, the feeling is that this is the end of the world. Once the tsunami starts climbing up on dry land, it's moving at the speed of maybe, you know, anywhere between 10 to 20 miles per hour. It's almost like being in a 20,000 mile per hour wind. Nothing can stop it. It's not even a question of being scared. The moment that you see the tsunami, most people freeze.
Offers a chilling parallel.
The Minoans are so confident in their navy that they're living in unprotected cities all along the coastline. These were the major population centers. That's where people are living. Now you go to Banda Aceh and you find that the mortality rate is 80%. If we're looking at a similar mortality rate in late Minoan 1A Thera eruption period Crete, that's the end of the Minoans.
But this male statue found at Palaecastro offers a terrible clue to what might have happened after the wave.
He's made of ivory tusks, gold. He has a serpentinite head, and he is one of the great masterpieces of Minoan art. His cuticles are even carved. He's given pulsating veins. The sculptor wanted him to be alive.
But someone destroyed it. This masterpiece was deliberately smashed and burned. Such energy went into its destruction that it was discovered shattered into hundreds of pieces, both inside and outside the shrine that housed it.
This was a valuable piece. Anybody who had this in his possession would have been rich, but they did not care. They wanted to destroy the statue. Somebody picked up the statue from its base and brought it outside. He took the statue and smashed the face into probably this side of the wall and made the stone hair fall and have the torso and the arms drop in front of the steps of the shrine and threw in the legs in the burning house.
Is this graphic evidence of a society in meltdown? Did the poor rebel against their rulers and overthrow the gods that had failed to protect them?
They really went for the face. And so we see that in all different kinds of civilizations, Egyptian or Roman, when they go for the face, there is something symbolic involved. They want to destroy everything this statue stood for.
Was the fate of the statue connected to an outburst of destruction that overtook the Minoans in around 1450 BC? In Hanyar, in western Crete, an excavation in the heart of the modern town has revealed evidence of arson.
These are the stones that are in such a condition because of the strong fire.
It's a pattern repeated in other sites across the island. Was this a revolution within Minoan society, or is it evidence of conquest by outsiders? Archaeologist Maria Vlasecki believes she's found the answer. She's discovered a highly unusual cemetery in Hanyar. It dates from the same period as the widespread destruction in the Minoan world.
These are warrior graves. They are single burials, something that is in opposition with the traditional Cretan Minoan customs. They have the age of between 24 to 30. They are tall, robust. They look to be invaders.
These invaders have only ever been found once before on Crete, at Knossos. But now we have evidence of them elsewhere. It suggests an invasion from the west, from the mainland of Greece.
They have a lot of weapons, long swords like the ones that are in Knossos and in Peloponnese.
The invaders from the Peloponnese slashed and burned their way across Crete, overwhelming the Minoans. Sandy McGillivray believes that the tsunami may have helped the Mycenaeans attack Crete.
Their traditional homeland is on the southern shores of the Gulf of Corinth. The tsunami cannot get into the Gulf of Corinth. To get into there, you have to go all the way around to the west through a little narrow opening. So the Mycenaean Greeks up there are probably the only people left, maybe even in the eastern Mediterranean, with a navy. This is power.
Did these Greek invaders encounter a dark side of Minoan culture? Close by the great bull frescoes in Knossos, archaeologists have found grisly human remains.
One of the most telling and horrifying deposits from the post-Theron eruption period in Crete was a deposit recovered in the town of Knossos up along the Royal Road, and that was these cannibalized youths. The analysis of these bones from this burnt destruction deposit strongly suggested that they'd been hacked up in order to take the flesh off in order to eat them. This cannibalistic aspect of the Minoans is probably one of the things that was recalled when the Greeks first arrived in Crete. Fear and loathing at Knossos.
Was this the origin of the Minotaur myth? Did the Greeks imagine that these unlucky victims had been led into the labyrinth to be sacrificed to the Minoan bull god? Within a generation of their arrival, the Greeks had completely conquered Crete. The last embers of Minoan culture flickered out. Sandy and his team have unearthed evidence that they believe resolves the mystery of how the first great European culture disintegrated at the peak of its power.
This is a major discovery now, because what it's doing is it's helping us to rewrite a chapter in Minoan archaeology, in the history of the Minoans.
This is absolutely exciting. I mean, it's just, even in my wildest dream, when I started becoming a scientist, did I ever think that I would be working on understanding the demise of the Minoans and what happened back then in the second millennium BC?
This may be as close as we will ever come to unraveling Plato's tantalizing description of Atlantis. Was the mythical city a folk memory of a great civilization shattered by an ancient tsunami? If you want to discuss their theory with Sandy and the team, why not log on to bbc.co.uk/timewatch.
Comedy with QI here in 10 minutes on BBC Two, but stay with us till then, you'll love this. The playful, stately stoats of Kedleston Hall, next.